Well, good morning. I hope that everyone's doing all right. I went up with a team that largely was connected to Christian Healing Ministries in Jacksonville. We went up to Fort Valley, Georgia, and had a really tremendous time working some of the kind of ideas that we've gone over with Russ Parker connected to healing churches in a city, and in this case, in terms of racial reconciliation. And it was a tremendous beginning. You never know how, when you start plowing things up, how things will continue, but for a beginning couple days, it was really fantastic. We had a tremendous time there, and a little tired. We got in about midnight, but it's not going to slow me down in my sermon. So I don't want to get you excited here. All right. Let me remind you that this Friday is the fish fry in the Stations of the Cross, where once a year we go over to Holy Faith Catholic Church and we do that together. We would love for you to participate, for us to go as a church, and we would like you to sign up and then to stay and eat a meal. Now, in the past, two things have happened. One, we've had people sign up and then not go. Well, since they're making us dinner, obviously, if you can't go, don't sign up. But if you sign up, please be there, because it's obviously, if they cook 20 meals and we don't come, they do that for, you know, they take care of it for us. I've tried to pay. They won't let us. It's a very kind thing. And so we want you to come, sign up, and then show up. It's a really wonderful thing that Mary Shaw is now on a mission trip in, I guess she's in Slovakia, not Slovenia, but Slovakia. And she is the one who all these years, last 20 years, has helped us have such a great relationship with Father John, you know, that's a really neat thing. We're you know, after a long time, our church, we love everybody who loves Jesus, and we try to, as much as we can, support, encourage, and bless everybody. We don't pretend to be sort of the, some small churches pretend that we're small because we're just so much better, and then some big churches think they're big, but the truth is, we're all in the kingdom, and we're just so grateful to be our little part of the kingdom in Gainesville, and to do what we do, and we're so thankful that there's so many other good churches in this city. And Father John, some of you remember his testimony. He got saved in an Episcopal church. Strangely enough, in the 70s, he was, I think, Methodist, but I don't think they ever went to church. And then when he came to Gainesville in the 70s, he found the Episcopal church too liberal, and so he went to the Catholic church, and so he became a Catholic priest. Like a number of the Roman Catholic priests in Gainesville that I know of, probably three or four of them, are very straightforward with the fact they have a relationship with Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That's a really neat thing. I think there's people who know Jesus as Savior and Lord who don't use the words the same way we use the words. But the ones in Gainesville, they even, not only do they have that, but they even are, you know, they're even kind enough to say it in a way that we understand that they get it, you know, and they don't have to do that, but we're very grateful for that, and it's a very wonderful thing. So in any case, please make that a priority, and let's do that together. Oh, the other problem is, often we go, now I'm kind of privileged, I get to sit with Father John, and so I don't, you know, spread out, but when you go, as best you can, try to sit by someone from Holy Faith. The last couple of years, it seemed like we just had people from Holy Faith sitting someplace and people from St. Andrews, which, hey, a free dinner's a free dinner. I'd still go. I mean, I'm not saying, but obviously part of the idea is that we would get to know some of the people and interact, and I know that's uncomfortable, but on the other hand, that's part of what is the love of Christ, that we say, hey, we're committed to get to know some people and all that, and as best you can, that would be really helpful. All right. Also, for those who are gifted with craft-type things, I'm not, but there is going to be a working party Saturday at 10 making the crosses for Palm Sunday. Now, I've seen the little instruction thing. Oh, you fold it. I'm not good with that stuff. But anyway, there will be a group of people having a good time. Cheryl's lead. Cheryl, would you stand up? Cheryl is going to be our fearless leader. Thank you. And there are people like Cheryl who can do this, and it seems simple and easy. I'm glad that you're good at it, and lots of other people are, but that's not something I'm good at. But if you would, those are going to be, you know, I don't know if there's a sign-up or not, but I'm sure they could use help. We normally make a couple hundred of them, and or 150, I don't know what they're going to make, but they got it figured out, and we appreciate it so much. We've done some years, we just gave the palm fronds out, but it wasn't that nice, and so we've gone back. We even bought some crosses of the palms folded, but then they're always already, they've been done in advance, and so they're all brown and dead, which eventually is going to happen, but it's nice to get them fresh, and I guess they even put in the refrigerator, which is, anyway. People like me are impressed with that. You're probably not impressed, but anyway. Then the last thing is the Easter lilies. For those who'd like to participate on Easter, we have lilies and things, and then that we decorate the altar area with, and then after the service, you're welcome to take those. After the second service, you're welcome to take those. So if you'd like to be part of that, that would be great. The cost, everything is there. So this morning, would you turn with me to Joshua chapter 9? I don't know why you're here this morning, but I do have a feeling, because the Lord gave me a kind of a strange word. And you might say, all my sermons are strange, but this is not the type of scripture I would typically preach on in terms of certainly not Lent or anything, but the Lord's really speaking to me about this text. And sometimes the Lord, I think, wants to rescue us, and he gives us a lifeline. And I feel like this morning's sermon is a lifeline. So, Joshua chapter 9, let me tell you a little bit of background. Number one, the Israelites, when they were told to go in to take the land after the 40 years in the wilderness and everything else, they were told to go in and take the land. Now, they were told that all the people that were living in the land of Canaan, where they were going to take over, that they were to kill all those people, meaning men, women, children, dogs, everything. I mean, everything was going to be Holocaust. It was going to be done that way. Now, that is disturbing. For obvious reasons, that's a disturbing thing. And all I can tell you is there's a couple things, the best that we can tell, that we think is why that's the case. Because there was all the people, you know, in the ancient world, they were idolaters and they were evil. But remember that it took 400 years, the Bible said, before the wickedness of the Canaanites reached its fullness before God would send the Israelites in there to clean them out. And I want you to remember that in the ancient world, things like child sacrifice and sex with animals and all kinds of different things, that part of the problem in Canaan was those people were particularly given to demons, in the sense that they did things sexually, they did things killing their children, they wanted a promotion, and then they throw their kid in the fire and burn their kid to death to get favor with the gods. They were some very unusually and highly demonized people. And if you remember, before the cross of Jesus Christ, they couldn't just kick all those demons out. And so part of what God was doing, there were some people that were given to such a degree, they had made such a commitment to wickedness and evil that they weren't coming back. And so that even their animals, even their possessions, I mean, there were sometimes they could go in and win a war and then take their gold or their silver, and sometimes they were allowed to do that, take the spoils. But the things were so demonized, so cursed with the people in Canaan that they weren't allowed to even benefit from any of it. No animals, none of the money, none of the jewels, nothing, because it had been given so completely to the demonic. Now, that still may not satisfy you. Be satisfied or not. I guess I'm utterly convinced that I know how God's mercy was to give Jesus on the cross. And I'm convinced if there was any way to show them mercy, he would have. And my instinct is he showed a mercy for hundreds of years. Okay? But I don't have, other than that, an explanation. That's the best we can do. At least I can do. Now, so we have this situation in Joshua 9 where the Israelites make a covenant with the Gibeonites. And this covenant that they make, they were supposed to go in and kill the Gibeonites, everybody in Canaan, but the Israelites didn't do right. Now, they didn't do right twice. Joshua made two very big mistakes. Now, I want you to remember, Moses, the first time that he hit the rock with the water at the beginning of the 40 years, when he hit it the first time, that was a symbol of Christ being crucified. So the second time, at the end of the 40 years, when Moses beat the rock, when God said, call the water out of the rock, and he beat the rock, it disqualified him. Because in essence, the idea is that Jesus was only going to be beaten, crucified once, never to do again. So when Moses beat the rock, which was Christ in type, and when that happened, it disqualified Moses from entering in the promised land. Now, if you remember about Joshua, Joshua was one of the spies. And he and Caleb were the two spies that saw that no matter how big the enemy was, they understood that when God is with us, we're going to be okay. 10 of the spies were freaked out because the people were big and everything was fortified and they were giants and all that. But two people didn't see how big the giants were. They understood how big God was. Now, if you remember at the beginning, right before when Moses asked each of the tribes to give them a person to be one of the spies, when Joshua was called over, his name was not Joshua, his name was Oshua. And it means one who saves, like a champion. Like saying, yeah, you're a champion. That's not a bad name, right? But Moses immediately, before Joshua was allowed to go with the rest of them and go into the promised land, Moses changed his name to Yeshua, or Yahweh saves, Yahweh delivers. So that the idea of any kind of self-righteousness or, you know, like one who's like, so the focus wasn't on him as being this studly guy. Instead, it was that salvation is from God. All right. And it was a very important, it's amazing. If you read it, you can almost miss it. That's about 16 chapter. I guess I don't know if that's, I'm not sure what book. Anyway, maybe Deuteronomy. Anyway, wherever it is. I don't know, it can't be, it must be numbers. But anyway, wherever that is, when it happens, I mean, just right there, if you just, he's like saying, then this one from this tribe, this, and then Yeshua or Oshua, and then Moses changed his name to Yeshua. So anyway, so Joshua is a type of Christ, just as Moses was a figure, kind of helping us understand that what we needed as a leader. But Joshua made two very big mistakes. As good as he was, he seemed like almost like the sort of the perfect sweet person in a way. I mean, he just seemed to have faith and good, and his morals were good. But there was two big things he did. First, in chapter 7 of Joshua, he made the mistake of taking some bad advice. Have you ever been on some really smart people and taken their advice and it went south? Oh, boy. Well, then we got to ask the question, were the people really that smart? Well, no, I don't know. In Joshua chapter 7, verses 3 and 4, Joshua did not know that Achan had stolen some of the cursed money and wealth and buried it in his tent. But what that did, when they took those things which were cursed and they put them and brought them into the camp, it allowed the demonic to deceive people. And so the leaders, instead of acting wisely, they acted overconfidently and did not do the right thing. So as they were going in to Ai to destroy them, they said, well, Jericho was really big, but we're really strong. And of course, they're feeling really strong because God's been with them. They just had this incredible victory. I mean, they got out of Egypt. They thought they were going to die. They felt like cowards, but all of a sudden, you know, the Egyptians got swallowed up by the sea. I mean, all these miracles. So at this point, they're feeling pretty good about themselves. Whatever we do works. Of course, whatever they did worked because God was with them. And now they had not been obedient. No one knew that, but God knew that. And instead of inquiring of the Lord, Joshua took the advice of good people. Now, let me tell you something, how churches work. We are lucky. We have a church where our leaders and our vestries, they are people who pray. They don't just come and say, I got a good idea. We have people who pray about it and think about it. We want wise people, but we don't just want people with good ideas. There's all kinds of good ideas. In a town like Gainesville, there's smart people everywhere. When I first came to this church 20 years ago, we had people who had great ideas, and if I said to them, did you pray about it, they'd be offended. They looked at me like I'm crazy. And I'm thinking to myself, hey, I think about this 7 days a week. You think about it for 2 minutes, and we're supposed to wait 3 or 4 weeks thinking about something you haven't even prayed about. And they looked at me like I'm nuts. Listen, it is not enough to be smart. It's not enough to be intelligent. It's not enough to have smart, intelligent friends. It's not enough to have prophetic friends. One of the dangers of churches and with the gift of prophecy is operating is sometimes, instead of being benefited and encouraged by prophecy, people abdicate the responsibility of their inquiry of the Lord and they put it on people that are prophetic. And that is to misuse the prophetic gift. It's not necessarily the prophet. Meaning, people will go say, oh, you're kind of prophetic or you're spiritual. What do you think? Listen, that is to take a person with a gift from God and try to make them a medium. The responsibility of the important decisions of your life are the require of you and for me to inquire of the Lord. The prophetic can confirm. Sometimes it can help us to see what to pray about. I mean, the prophetic is a very important gift. But it is, whether it's intelligence, in some denominations, they wouldn't have believe in prophecy. So they might abdicate, and I've seen people and myself many times abdicate the responsibility of praying because I couldn't hear anything. And because I couldn't hear anything, I abdicate the responsibility to other people that I consider to be godly. And I did what they said. And they gave me good advice. The problem was, many times good advice is not God advice. Because God can see things that are beyond the capacity of human reason and beyond those experiences that we figured out in the past. I mean, that's why he says in Isaiah 42:16, I take the blind by the hand and I show them the way that they don't know, on paths they don't know. It is precisely because God can see what's around the corner. He can see what's happening with the economy. He can see this and he can see that. And therefore, it is always wise to inquire of God first. Now, I said earlier I couldn't hear from God. The truth is, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. The problem was I did not settle down to learn and to grow in the discipline of discerning, Lord, is this your voice? Is it the devil or is it me? The Bible says Jesus is speaking all the time. It's not that God's not speaking. It's that with some of us, and certainly me as a pastor for many years, I had not learned how to hear God's voice. Well, there's many good books and things on it, but by the way, the Southern Baptist Blackaby's got one of the best ones ever. I always kind of tease that the Blackaby allowed evangelicals to believe in hearing God's voice again. He gave permission. Before Blackaby, the Baptists want to kill you if you talk about hearing God's voice. But when a Southern Baptist wrote a great book on hearing God's voice, then it was okay. But a lot of people are still suspicious. Because you know why people are suspicious about hearing God's voice? Because you can still get it wrong because we're imperfect. So the idea that we can get it wrong makes a lot of people say, well, then I won't try at all. And they'll focus not on the times they've learned and grow from the good things. They'll get all focused because of self-righteousness and pride on the times they don't. If you want to focus on the reality that you can make a mistake, you'll never advance in the kingdom. There's a lot of, Lord, forgive me. I got it wrong. I'm sorry. I mean, if you're going to grow in the kingdom, you got to deal with the fact that you're imperfect and that I'm imperfect. And that we're not in control. We cannot safeguard ourselves from any mistakes. But God honors people who pursue him, even though we do it imperfectly. So at the time that I was abdicating responsibility, I didn't know that sometimes it takes 3 years. When there was a famine in the land with David, it says he prayed, he inquired of the Lord, but God didn't answer for 3 years. Sometimes the reason that you haven't heard is because God's saying, keep praying. The old people used to say this, pray until you pray. That sounds like a haiku or something, right? Or Zen or something. Pray until you pray. What's that mean? It means pray until you meet with God and God hears and answers. Pray until you connect with the Holy Spirit. Sometimes it can take 3 years to get what you need. But the point is, if it takes 3 years or 400 years like it did at the Exodus, you pray until you hear from God. And if you haven't heard from God, don't just guess and bluff. And I think that's the word this morning. I think there's people making decisions right now that they're getting ready to get in covenants and things with people that will be a big mistake. Because you have gotten good advice, you've thought about it, you're acting wisely, but you have not inquired of God. Now, one other principle at the beginning, and then we'll look at the text and work it through. Susan and I, when we make decisions, important decisions, sometimes we've made decisions we didn't understand how important they were, but we weren't as careful. But when we knew it was an important decision, we have not made important decisions unless we both agreed. Part of the reason I'm still here 20 years later is I came here to interview 20 years ago, and she didn't. And so when I came, I thought I heard the Lord say we're going there, but she didn't. If she had come, I think we would have been on the same page. But because she didn't, she didn't. And it took us, the church made me an offer 20 years ago in August, and I said, Susie is not on board, and so will you give us more time? They gave me like 2 weeks or something reasonable, but I said, we're not on the same page. Will you give me more time? And they chose to. And it actually took us 6 weeks. But I'll tell you what the benefit was. When we finally, both of us heard together that we're going to Gainesville, we knew that we both had heard. That's how you live through 4 church splits. Because I knew what it was like when God told me to come here. And so until I heard him tell me to leave, I couldn't do it. If a decision comes up, listen carefully, and you've inquired the Lord and you have not heard an answer, it means that you will miss the opportunity. Miss the opportunity. If you are, they need an answer by next Wednesday on the house. If the Lord hasn't spoken to you, don't do it. This is Lent. Why am I preaching a sermon like this? I'm assuming someone, I don't mean it has to be a house, but whatever. I got a feeling people are in a season where they're making decisions and they've listened to good advice, they've listened to common sense, they've listened to the fact of intelligence and what people say and all kinds of different things. And maybe they listen to the prophetic. The question is, have you inquired of the Lord? Do you know what the prophets told Paul? The prophets told Paul, don't go down to Jerusalem, because if you go to Jerusalem, you're going to die. Were the prophets right? Yes. Did Paul listen to him? No. Why? Because he knew, but Jesus told him to go. See, sometimes the prophets can see something. So the prophets heard, if you go, you'll die. So they added, you shouldn't go. Paul said, did not say they weren't right in what that he was going to die. I think he saw that. But he said, but I've got to go. God's telling me to go. You cannot abdicate responsibility. Sometimes prophetic people, they're hearing correctly, but they're misinterpreting the punchline. In the context of the curse and land, somehow the wisdom of the leaders of Israel, which was generally good, got off. And they said to them, said in Joshua 7, they said, the way that God's with us, just take a couple thousand people and we'll go down and kill them. That's not anything compared to what we've been through. And those people killed 36 of them and 3,000 people ran home. Because they didn't realize, they had not inquired the Lord. They did not realize that they had been unprotected spiritually and the enemy had the right to destroy them. Because they were thinking instead of praying. Now, this is a great story. You probably don't even remember it, but it's a really good story. Let's look at it, and then there's a punchline for us, which I've already hit about 10 times, but I'm assuming you'll need 12 or 13 before you get out of here. We used to say, you know, our idea is, if it doesn't hurt, you haven't been in church. Listen, if this saves you from making a bad decision, it's going to be really good. I've sensed the Lord's like pleading this morning. Not like, he's not telling us, this word is not like, oh, we're bad people. Listen, we're all good people. We all want to please the Lord. We just got to be careful. Sometimes we don't understand the rules. And the rules are, we cannot abdicate responsibility of inquiring of the Lord. Here we go. And it came to pass, verse 1 of chapter 9. It came to pass when all the kings who were on the side of who are on this side of the Jordan. Now he's talking reflexively, western side, because they were still talking about moving out that way. Who on the west side of Jordan, in the hills and in the lowland and all the coast of the great sea toward Lebanon, the Hittite, the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Perizzite, again, I don't say all these words right, the Hivite and the Jebusite, they heard about it. Well, you better believe they heard about when Jericho, an impossible city to crack, came down. Believe me, they were hearing. And when they heard that when they went in, they didn't even take the money, they slaughtered and destroyed everything. And then they heard about how, though I had that city of Ai had this temporary thing, they went back and destroyed all of them. So you can imagine, everybody was talking, and people sensed more was going on, and that it was not looking good. Now, five of those groups came together to fight the Jews, but the Gibeonites were the smart ones, the Hivites. And by the way, the word Hivite means serpent. And the Gibeonites are Hivites. And so what the deal is they recognize this isn't looking good. Do you know what really upset the people, the people in Canaan that realized? It's that they went, and after killing the people in Jericho and going into Ai, they went back to, is it Gilgad or Eliab or whatever, and they did the thing where they repeated the covenant. They redid the Ten Commandments. They redid the curses and the blessings in that valley. And that shook up the powers of the demonic in the country. And those people start to freak out. The demons in them start to freak out. And so they all try to come together and band against the Jews. But the Gibeonites understood, kind of like Rahab, they realized, we're not going to make it. It doesn't matter. Their God is bigger than our God. We're going down. They got that. So they realized, we're not going to win by direct conflict. We're going to deceive them. This is what you need to know. We get the obvious stuff. The demonic, once we learn about the obvious stuff, he then sends things that look a certain way, and in your natural reason and senses, you will not be able to figure it out if you don't inquire of the Lord. Watch this. So they gather together, the five of them, to fight with Joshua and Israel with one accord. They end up getting destroyed massively, and big story. But three, here's the people we want to listen to. But when the inhabitants of Gibeon heard what Joshua had done to Jericho and Ai, they worked craftily. I think it's the King James that says wily, like Wile E. Coyote, you know. So, and they went and pretended to be ambassadors. And they took old sacks on their donkeys and old wineskins torn and mended, old and patched sandals on their feet and old garments on themselves, and all the bread of their provision was dry and moldy. See, they didn't want the Israelites to realize that they were in Cana. They realized if we're in Cana, we're going to be destroyed. But if we act like we came from Turkey, are far away, maybe they'll make a covenant. Maybe they'll join with us. So we'll trick them in everything we do when they see our, you know, provisions. I mean, how long, if you took a tuna fish sandwich in Gainesville and you carried it in your backpack for 3 or 4 days, what's it going to look like? Okay, so it's like Israel. So the idea is everything's looking molded like they came from a long way. So they're not coming from a long way. So they get all this moldy food and stuff, which begs the question, why do they have all this moldy food? But that's another thing for another day. So they got all this moldy food and stuff so they can look like, oh, they've come from a long, long way to get here. So we're not going to just have to destroy them. That's the idea. 6, and they went to Joshua to camp at Gilgal, and he said to them, to the men of Israel, we have come from a far country, and therefore now make a covenant with us. See, when you make a covenant in God's name, you're bound by it. You're bound by it even if the person tricked you. Did you know that? When you give your word, if you've not inquired the Lord and you get taken in by somebody, the Bible says a righteous man keeps his word even to his harm. I mean, I hate to say it. That's not the way hillbillies think. We think, well, if you cheat us, this deal's off. So we're all getting corrected here. No, the Israelites said when they made a deal in the name of the Lord, they were bound by it. Seven, then the men of Israel said to Hivites, perhaps you dwell among us. I mean, perhaps you're really from right here. Maybe you're tricking us. So how can we make a covenant with you? But they said to Joshua, we're your servants. We're just people who want to serve you, and we're subordinate to you, and we recognize, man, you're anointed, and you got all the power. You're great people. Look what he said. Look at this. And Joshua said to them, where are you, where you come from? They said to him, verse 9, from a very far country. Lie. Your servants have come. Because of the name of the Lord your God. Now that is true. They recognized God's power, but they weren't there to submit to God. The devil sent them to get them in. The only way the Jews could get messed up was to act in disobedience and to open the door to the devil. The devil sent them, gave them a plan. They pretended to be legit. This happened in churches and leaders all the time. Not at St. Andrew's, thank God. But it could happen to all of us. Everybody who says they want revival, everybody says they want this, aren't telling the truth. Some of them know they're not telling the truth, and some of them don't know. We come from a very far country. Your servants have come because of the name of the Lord your God, for we have heard of his fame and all that he did. See, they're flattering them. I mean, it's true, but they're flattering them. Because they're there to deceive him and to lie. They're not there to be legit. And all that he did, we heard of this fame. And 10, and all that he did in the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan to Shihon, I can't say the name right, Heshbon and Og, king of Bashan, and all that were at Ashtaroth. 11, therefore our elders and all the inhabitants of our country spoke to us, saying, take provisions with you for the journey, and go to meet them and say to them, we are your servants now, therefore make a covenant with us. If the enemy, if the devil can get us to make a covenant with people who are not about God's business, it will open us up to destruction. Be very careful who you make business agreement. Be very careful who you're holding hands with. Because everybody who says it and says they're Christian, this and that. I mean, there was a time in the 80s and 90s where the Christian directory for plumbers and stuff, you would almost guarantee you got to cheat. Everybody's a Christian to get business. But they didn't act like Christians. You don't know a Christian plumber or electrician because they call themselves a Christian plumber. You don't, because they keep the word and they do good work. And there's tons of good Christian tradesmen stuff, but just everyone who said it isn't true. It got to the point where I was pretty much, if it was in a Christian director, I didn't use it. I'm sure there were some good ones. But I had been burned so many times, and then people said, oh, I can't believe those Christians. I said, just because they called themselves Christians doesn't make them Christians. I just was too dumb to know that. 11. Now the elders and all the inhabitants of our country spoke to us, saying, take provisions with you for the journey, go to meet them, and say to them, we are your servants. Now therefore make a covenant with us. 12. This bread of ours, look, the bread. This bread of ours we took hot for our provision from our houses on the day we departed to come to you. And look how moldy it is. But look, it's dry and it's moldy. Look how long it would take to do that. 13. And these wineskins which were filled with new, and see, they're torn, and these are garments. We're from Russia. I don't know, you know, where they thought, but anyway, a long way to have all to have to repair everything, right? So look, if the children of Israel are going to look at their eyes and use their brains, they're going to fall for it. Because they cannot see with their senses and their rational mind what they have to see. Only God can reveal it. No matter how smart you are or how smart your friends are, what God wants to protect you from, you cannot see with the natural mind. None of us are smart enough. There are things only God can see. Circumstantial changes that, you know, how many of us have planned business and done things, but all of a sudden some part of the market changed, and everything, if it had been the same, it would have worked, but things weren't the same. Only God knows those things. At 14. Then the men of Israel took some of their provisions. They felt, oh yeah, it really is moldy. And look, look, their sandals are bad. And look, the wineskins are messed up. But they did not ask the counsel of the Lord. There's the punchline for you. They did not ask the counsel of the Lord. Let me ask you a question. What is going on in your life where you've gotten good advice, you've thought about it, you figured it out, but you have not gotten counsel of the Lord? Oh, maybe you prayed about it, but you didn't hear back, and so you're planning on moving ahead. If you haven't heard back, don't move ahead. Did you hear that? Listen, this is a lot of, I mean, I know you think it's a lot of left field sermon. It is. It's like yesterday, the night, I had 3 hours to be praying. I had a whole different sermon out of 2 Samuel. And this is actually part of the background for what I was preaching in 2 Samuel, preparing 2 Samuel. And the Lord's like, this is the only thing he let me focus on. They did not inquire of the Lord. If you don't know how to hear God's voice, you better start learning quickly. I mean, you may not have any major decision this moment, but you can't wait till it's time to make a decision about marriage or buying a house or changing a job. You can't wait to then and say, oh, now I need to learn this skill. Because it is a skill to learn to discern. Do you know how you learn how to pray? You start praying with other people who do know how to pray. You start learning the scriptures about prayer. I mean, there's all kinds of ways to learn to hear God's voice. But what you need to, God is speaking even if I don't know how to pick up the frequency yet. And if you know how to hear his voice, you may not shortcut or abdicate the responsibility because of the wisdom of anybody. Not bishop, not because bishops are bad, hopefully, or priests or prophetic people, but because we are not mediums. We are not mediums. The gift of prophecy is not a means to hear from heaven apart from you hearing from Jesus. It is a gift that supports and helps. It helps bring confirmation. It often brings light so that we can then pray. You know, if you get a prophetic word, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to pray until God shows you 2 or 3 confirmations. You're not supposed to be going, oh, some prophet told me at a conference, this and that. I mean, it's great if they told you that, but did you hear it from God? I mean, that's one time. Did you get confirmation? You have to have confirmation. And then you got to ask more questions, by the way. In my life, I've not done so well on this in different ways, and I'll give you an example, and that is that I would hear from the Lord to do something, like, you're going to go to a mission, or you're going to do this, or I'd be at the church here in the last 20 years, I'd be thinking, and I'd be like, the Lord, tell me something, and I'd rush ahead and do it, and it didn't work. And then I'd be mad at God. God, I prayed, and you told me, and so I have the friend Todd up in Canada, Bishop Todd, and one time I asked him, I said, well, Todd, you don't seem to make the same kind of mistakes I make. What do? He said, well, first, he says, when I'm praying and God tells me something, he says, I write it down. He said, and then I pray until I get two or three confirmations. And then I pray, okay, if this is what you want me to do, Lord, okay, where do you want me to do it? He said, I ask the next question. And then I pray, and sometimes it takes a week or a day or 3 months, and I get that, and then I get my two or three confirmations for that. And then he says, well, what's the strategy when I get there? Oh, I never thought of asking these kind of questions. So he would get the strategy. So he'd pray until he got the strategy. And then he'd get confirmation for that. And that could take a month, 2 months, 3 months. And then he'd say, well, who am I supposed to do it with? These are all questions I never dreamed of asking. I just would hear God say, do something. I never said when, how, with who. I never asked those questions. So I was always doing things that God said, but not in God's timing, not out in alignment with his purpose, not by the right way. And so I would hear God and then get offended with God because I didn't ask the kind of questions I was supposed to ask. And it's only when I started praying with people who had more sense and I noticed didn't seem to hear from God and run into a wall all the time that I learned, oh, there is a way. Because I thought, here's a guy, he does it, and it doesn't go bad for him all the time. Now, he learned that, of course, doing it the wrong way. But the point is, he asked more questions when he got it wrong, and that's how he learned. And other people taught him. Joshua did not inquire of the Lord. The people did not inquire of the Lord. They abdicated responsibility of what they could see, what they thought. They were all smart people. They were all godly people. But that will not make up for not asking God and hearing from God. Where have you abdicated spiritual responsibility in your life to someone else, no matter how wonderful, how godly, instead of making sure that you are hearing from God for yourself? If you plan to be the kind of Christian, you're going to be around a church where people hear from God and you'll just go get prayer and listen, you're going to get crunched. Okay, we do have people in this church who hear from God prophetically beautifully. And God wants to use them, and he is using them, and they confirm things, and they even show us things that we then confirm and hear from God. But you cannot take the prophetic word without hearing God's voice and getting those things confirmed and move ahead and think you're safe. Does that make any sense? God, I'm telling you this because God wants to protect you. There are decisions that are coming that if we are not careful, sometimes in our immaturity, God kind of lets us away from things, and he protects us even though we break the rules. But then there's a place of maturity in our lives where God says, okay, you're not a baby anymore. And now you have to learn, and you've got to grow, and you can't just be keep abdicating responsibility. It won't happen. The fact that God graciously has saved us many times from foolishness does not mean we're allowed to keep acting foolishly and abdicating responsibility in our spiritual life. This is not a word of even correction. It's a word of safety and blessing. These are the rules. If we do them God's way, we will be blessed. We will be protected. But no matter how brilliant and wonderful you are, I am, if we do not follow the rules, it's not going to go well with us. Now, lest you think I'm talking to you, and my suspicion in almost every sermon is that God is warning me. Meaning, I don't think I'm supposed to warn you because I couldn't make the same mistake. Do you understand? When I preach, I'm preaching to me, and I'm thinking, oh boy, when am I trying to do the right thing with good people, but I didn't check? Because Joshua was about as good a guy as there ever was. And he did a whole lot of good, but on a couple key places, he made some assumptions and did not go back and hear from the Lord, and it wrecked some things. They didn't stop the whole thing. They got in, but some people died and some bad things happened that didn't have to happen. All right, I want you to close your eyes. Well, you don't have to close your eyes. I say that because I was raised in the Baptist church. Close your eyes. But you don't have to. You don't have to. If you, You don't have to rebel. If you don't feel like, don't. I want you to ask the Lord, Lord, what decisions are coming or am I in the middle of where I've been getting good advice and I've been thinking issues that are important? We may not even know how important, but Lord, what are the ones that you want to bring to mind right now? Maybe we've been asking everybody for their thoughts, taking polls. But once we've not inquired of the Lord. Lord, we repent. We're so sorry, Lord. We just didn't know how to do it very well, and so we've substituted other people's thoughts and opinions and our own thoughts and opinions and experts' opinions and good books and all kind of stuff, but we have not made it our main concern to hear from you. And Lord, we are so sorry. We ask for your protection. Some of us, we're down the road on this thing. We see, we opened ourselves up because it's exactly what we've just done. So Lord, we stop right here and we say, we're so sorry. For years, we had opportunity to learn how to hear your voice. We didn't do it. But Lord, we commit ourselves. We ask for your protection and your help right now in the mess that we're in. And then we commit ourselves to learn how to hear your voice. Lord, forgive us. Protect us even in our mistakes and our sinfulness because of the blood of Jesus. We ask you, Lord. And Lord, as we get disciplined in this crunch, we realize you're teaching us and that this is not the end of the story and we can learn and go from here. And whatever we made up, messed up here, we will do it better next time. And you'll take care of us even though we did it wrong. You did it with Joshua, Lord. Lord, you loved him and you used him powerfully and he even helps us to see Jesus. And so, Lord, if you can still work with Joshua and he made mistakes, you can still love us and help us too. But Lord, I pray for those things that are going on right now where there feels to be this panic and urgency and it's really fear where we feel like we just got to move ahead and we're not listening to the still small voice of the Holy Spirit. We cannot honestly say we've heard what God says about this thing. We're flying by the seat of our pants and we're claiming it's we prayed about it. When the truth is we haven't prayed until we've heard from heaven. Lord, help us to pray until we pray. Now, Lord, you love each of those here this morning, so I bless them. Lord, I need to grow. And Lord, you've been so gracious to me despite so much immaturity through the years and so many things I can't even see now that you still want to grow and fix. But Lord, as the pastor here, I bless these friends, Lord, this family of mine, that you would open up their eyes and their ears and that you would teach us and give us a grace to be sensitive to your spirit, to your voice, that we would learn to hear. And then, Lord, that we would obey. And Lord, when we get it wrong, that we'd be quick to repent and say, dear Lord Jesus, I'm so sorry. Lord, help us. Because Lord, we get offended with you instead of repenting. Lord, I pray particularly against the spirit of offense that would blame you for our recklessness and our foolishness. Oh, Lord Jesus, cleanse us because you love us so much. Lord, you want to bless us this morning. Lord, I pray that as we commit ourselves to you and to inquire of you in our lives, to put our steps before you, Lord, we ask that you'd bless us profoundly, that we would be your light in this generation and that we would be faithful stewards of all the blessings that you give us. We ask these things in the most precious and wonderful name, the name of Jesus, and in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven.